Well, this video definitely falls into the what were you thinking category, so make sure you stay tuned and watch this. Now, the first thing I want you to remember is that I've been in this game for a long time, 35 years as a digitizer, or puncher, as it used to be called. In the first 15 years, I was actually a commercial digitizer. I digitized for large-scale manufacturers. We had two factories, and designs had to be done so they were production-friendly, because a machine makes money based on how the design runs. If a design is bad, you're going to lose money very, very quickly. Now, in the commercial industry, it's a little bit different because designs have to be perfect. It's the corporate identity. But when I say perfect, I'm not talking about designs being exactly like the artwork, because we're not dealing with ink, we're dealing with thread. Well, here's what happened. I saw somebody post something on our Facebook group, and it was a very, very detailed corporate design. You can see it here. Lots of stuff going on, and I kind of thought to myself, that kind of looks like fun. People were, you know, they're saying, well, what do I do first? What do I do second? I saw everybody chime up, and they were giving little answers, and I got to be honest, I could have written a whole book on how to digitize this design, so I thought, why not do a video? Well, that's where it comes down to the what was I thinking, because I did contact the person by messenger. I had them send me the file, and I digitized this design by scratch, and very quickly when I got into it, all of those memories, the floodgates opened, and I remembered about all my commercial digitizing days. And I gotta be honest, I am so happy to do what I do now, which is just stuff like this. This is the next one that's actually on my agenda. A nice freestanding lace design for Classic Sewing magazine, or yesterday I digitized a really cool Mylar skull. And I love this stuff because nobody complains about the end result. But when you're talking commercial punching, when you're talking about corporate digitizing, it has to be done right. So the idea is we're going to dive into this artwork. We're going to take a look at it at a 6-to-1 scale so that we can see the reality of how much or how little detail we can get in. And then I'm going to very quickly show you how I sequenced and pathed my way through all of the colors and the objects so that it would be production friendly. I'm not going to digitize this from beginning to end and explain my way through it, because there's just way, way too much going on here. So if I look at the artwork right now, I can see that this design is going to be 3.5 inches in height approximately. And if I go to my 6-to-1 scale, it is going to zoom up substantially. That is what I would be looking at. And keep in mind that I have a 27-inch monitor that I'm actually viewing this artwork at. So if I try to relate this into thread, there is just so many details that I am going to have to simplify if I want to get good results. So I'm going to go out to my full size here, and there we can see the difference. And just to give you an idea, if I'm looking at these two, you can see that I have simplified the detail in a huge way, but keep in mind that that is the actual size right there. I would not be able to get every single feather and all the details in there, because it would be a bulletproof mess. So I'm going to go back to my full scale. I'm going to zoom into this just so that I see the actual design. And we're going to do a little slow redraw through this so that you can see how I would have sequenced this. Let's just go over so you see it all on screen. And I'm going to go to my player, and the first thing I want you to see is that I did a fill stitch, which is going to be a horizontal fill. So it's just going to go down like that. And that fill stitch is going to go from the bottom to the top. So it's keeping one consistent stitch from the bottom all the way to the top. I did not carve holes inside of all of the areas within the Spartan shield, because carving holes does actually add stitches, and it sort of corrupts the pathing, so you get some funny push and pull compensation and you don't get nice, you know, smooth looks. So after I've done that, then I right away go in and I'm doing this you know, part of the sword, which is underneath, and I had to make a decision. Even though in the artwork there is different shading in there, I'm going to use one color of gray, because I imagine the sword being gray, and then I'm going to go to the point of doing each of the little lightning bolts on either side. I am exaggerating the pull compensation on the lightning bolts, because that is a long satin stitch. And then I'm doing a fill that's opposing the direction of the original fill so that it will loft on top and not sink in. Again, adjusting push and pull compensation. And then I'm getting into the detail of the design. So I'm going to get into the details on the other side here. And I am also increasing the amount of pull compensation on these, because I am going to outline some of these to give as much detail as possible. I want to make sure that I do just enough so that the person's imagination can fill in the blanks. That's the key when you're doing this type of work. Now keep in mind that I have done three colors so far. Now I'm outlining these objects right away. I want to go in there and make sure that everything is outlined and completed so that the registration is going to be perfect. Then I'm doing the little handle here, and then I'm doing the black inside of the wings of the eagle. And I'll just continue on and do this. I'm really finishing all of the detail and the work within this first part of the design, even though, you know, many times there's other colors that could be done outside. I have to look at this in a way that I want it to line up perfectly, because I have all of these little outlines going around the wings. I have to adjust my push and pull compensation on every one of those outlines to make sure it's going to line up properly. And then I'm also doing all of the gold within the beak and the claws, and doing the detail within the snake and the outlines, and then doing a little bit of red. And then I'm continuing on and doing the snakes. Now I've really simplified. There are no scales. There's none of that stuff, because you wouldn't see it anyways, and you just get a bulletproof stitch intensive design. So now it's coming in and it's doing all of the underlay within the fill, and this fill is going a slightly different angle than the other fill. It really is irrelevant as long as I control the push and pull compensation, so I know it's going to sew out okay. And I'm going from the bottom to the top again as I go through. And then this is where it's going to get really interesting. I'm going to finish the fill, and then I'm right away going to do the lettering. But you're going to notice that when I do the lettering, there's not going to be any jumps or trims between any of the text. I start on this one part of the lettering, and then it's going to continue to go around, and I have a traveling stitch, and it goes in and through, but it's going the direction of the fill, so that it literally is hiding into the direction of the fill. There's absolutely no trims in this design at all. Again, I traveled between these words. You're not going to see them. By saving a few trims in production, and I probably saved 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, about 7 trims here. If I take 7 trims times by 150 stitches, that's about 1,000 stitches of production time that I've increased on this design. So even though it looks like there's a lot of stitches here, there's definitely less than 120 stitches, which is the average amount of production time that you lose on every jump and trim. And again, I'm traveling between these objects. Now, when I finish the lettering, it's going to start doing the borders around the outside. And you're going to notice that I also really look at how I do these little stars, because there's no jumps or trims from the stars. Everything travels from here, moving to this area. It's going to continue around the outside till it gets to the opposite side, where then it's going to do the other star and then travel to the outer edge. So you really have no unnecessary jumps and trims. I made sure that I controlled all of the start and stop points of every single object so that it would actually stitch out and make logical sense all the way through. So this is kind of the fun part. I got to be honest, it is like a puzzle. I've had to adjust, you know, underlays, densities, lower densities on objects that are going on top of objects. I've had to adjust pull compensation where I knew there would be outlines of things. And you know, this type of stuff, it kind of comes by years of experience and just, you know, kind of knowing what you're doing. But I've always said that the proof is in the stitching. So just to make sure this ran right, it looks great on screen, but we're going to show you the finished sample and show you exactly how it turned out. Now keep in mind, everything was manually digitized right down to the lettering. I didn't use any ESA fonts, which probably would have been okay, because I probably would have digitized them in the first place, but I wanted to do that the old school way. So here is the stitch out. This is the first stitch out that I did, and I did make a couple of tiny little tweaks to it. I did go in there and fix 2 or 3 small little things that I found. But gotta be honest, after all these years of digitizing and digitizing at a set scale, I pretty much know by looking on screen what the results are gonna be when they sew out, and they were still perfect. So I think I still got it. But anyways, that was kind of fun. I don't know if I'm gonna jump in on the next one quite so quickly. That might suffice for a little while, and hopefully I got my fill of old school manual corporate digitizing in. Appreciate you watching, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks for watching. If you want to make your embroidery life easier, be sure to hit the subscribe button below to be notified of new tips and tricks videos, giveaways, and more. Plus, if you want to try Hatch Embroidery software free for 30 days, or you already own Hatch and you'd like to download a free ESA font for it, click one of the links in the description below to learn more now. The next step of your embroidery legacy starts here with ours.